On behalf of the Mikvah Emunah Society of Greater Washington, I want to welcome everyone to the seventh event sponsored by the Robin Nyman Mikvah Education Fund. I would like to extend a special welcome to community Rebbetzins who are joining us this evening. Thanks to Zoom, we have people who may be joining us from outside our area. One of our goals is to create achdut in our community around our mikvah. If you are in the Greater Washington area, we would love for you to identify yourself as a local by clicking on the reaction icon at the bottom of your screen and clicking on the clapping hand, or feel free to raise your hand and wave if you have your camera on. And for our local audience, we hope you received the recent Mikvah Emunah Society mailing. We are in the midst of our annual membership drive, and we could use your support. As we emphasize each year, user fees alone do not cover the cost of our operations. We depend on you to ensure that the mikvah remains an integral part of Jewish life and of our local Jewish community. Your membership contribution ensures that we have funds to keep a safe environment for women to feel secure, especially during the pandemic, maintain our state-of-the-art facilities and equipment, and provide a clean and welcoming environment for all. We are putting a link in the chat to the www.mikvahemunah.com website, and you can click there to make your membership contribution.
Thanks, Sarit. My name is Julia Frankson Morris, and I'm also a member of the Robin Nyman Mikvah Education Fund Programming Committee. For those of you who didn't know her, Robin Nyman, Aleha Shalom, was the manager of the Wallerstein Mikvah here in Silver Spring before her Patira 2 years ago. She was a renowned mikvah educator and a dynamic teacher and social worker who transformed the experience for women going to the mikvah throughout the country. With the blessing of the Nyman family in 2020, the Mikvah Emunah Society established the Robin Nyman Mikvah Education Fund to honor Robin's memory and perpetuate her legacy. We hope that our efforts pay tribute to the significant contributions she made to our community, especially to the practice of Tirat HaMishpacha. The fund is dedicated to training mikvah attendants and greeters in our community and beyond, providing Tirat HaMishpacha and related educational programming, and sponsoring challah classes for brides in the greater Washington, D.C. community who are unable to pay for classes. A Robin Nyman Mikvah Education Fund Programming Committee, made up of women from many of the shuls in our area, has been planning online events. Since its inception, the committee has carried out six programs, hearing from renowned speakers on topics ranging from panel discussions on infertility, guidance from couples counselors, informative sessions on pelvic health, directions on how to discuss intimacy with your children, and most recently, tools and advice to help make mikvah preparations less stressful. If you missed any of our past events, recordings are available on our website. I will now introduce our moderator for tonight's program, Dalia Topolowski. Dr. Dalia Topolowski, PsyD, is a clinical psychologist in private practice at Integrative Therapy of Greater Washington, who specializes in both assessment and therapy for children, adolescents, and adults. She integrates a variety of techniques, including person-centered therapy, acceptance and commitment therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, and mindfulness techniques to help those struggling with life transitions, anxiety, depression, trauma, grief, and reproductive issues. Dalia is also a Rebbetzin at Kilat Pardes, the Rock Creek Synagogue, and has a passion for singing and creating spiritual women's programming. Dalia is married to Rabbi Uri and has four children ranging from 17 to 10 years old. Dalia, we'd now like to turn things over to you to introduce our program this evening. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It is truly an honor to be moderating this program tonight. So many of my own clients are women dealing with challenges and transitions in their own lives, and we are committed tonight to doing our best to educate about this really important topic and provide safe spaces for our panelists to share their stories, experiences, and lessons. This is a very sensitive and personal topic. The panelists will be sharing pieces of their stories and humanizing the perinatal mood disorder experience to educate us. We understand that this may be triggering for some, and it may resonate with some. Postpartum depression, as we all know, does not discriminate by race, economic status, religion, or any other category. In the chat, we'll be putting resources, national and local, for those in need and looking to learn more or to obtain help. So before we get started, here are just some housekeeping items. We've placed all of the participants on mute. and we ask you to keep yourself muted throughout the presentation. The Zoom chat function is currently set up so you could only send comments or questions to the host and our tech support, Chaichen. During the program, I'll be asking the panelists questions. And following the program, if time allows, we'll have an opportunity for a Q&A with Carly, our expert on the panel this evening. We're not sure if there will be time for the Q&A because we do have a lot to cover, but if there is time, the Q&A is meant for general education only, and we're not going to be able to address individual medical questions tonight. Questions will be accepted throughout the program by writing your question into the chat. And now for the program. It's an honor to welcome our panelists. Carly Chadash, an MSS LSW, is a licensed social worker and therapist who lives in the Lower Merion suburb of Philadelphia, where she also serves as director of the Lower Merion Community Mikvah. Carly has advanced training in sexual dysfunction, as well as perinatal mental health, and works to provide holistic support to the individuals and the couples she treats. Esty Schoenbrunn is an LMSW, CCTSI, a clinical therapist and a trauma specialist working in private practice. She's a crisis responder for Project Chai Mid-Atlantic Region and provides consultations to schools, educators, and parents navigating crisis and trauma. Esty has worked as a case manager for Chai Lifeline, helping families navigate through critical illnesses and coordinating practical support during difficult times. Esty and her husband Moshe have worked for 6 years in campus outreach at University of Arizona and University of Maryland. Esty is a mother to three and a survivor of perinatal and postpartum depression. And Alana Gottfried is an LMSW, CST, and AASECT certified sex therapist. She obtained both an undergraduate and graduate degrees in psychology and social work from Yeshiva University. In addition, Alana completed her postdoctorate training in sex therapy and sexuality education at the University of Michigan Sexual Health Certificate Program. She's been working in the field of sexual health for the past 12 years, maintains a private practice, and is a sex therapist at Beaumont Health's Women's Urology and Pelvic Health Center, providing psychotherapy to patients experiencing pelvic floor dysfunction. Alana has done extensive work with her community, providing education and resources to promote and encourage healthy sexual functioning. Her practice focuses mainly on women's sexual health, including but not limited to low sexual desire, orgasmic disorders, and pelvic pain. Alana is also a survivor of postpartum depression and anxiety. Carly, Esty, and Alana, thank you so much for joining us tonight. Carly, I want to start with you. Can you help us understand what we're talking about when we discuss perinatal mood disorders and postpartum depression?
Thank you so much for having me. I'm going to be sharing my screen to share a slideshow with you. I want to be really clear that I'm not going to have time to go through this entire slideshow. This is not an advanced level mental health training with continuing ed credits, but the PowerPoint is a resource that the Education Fund is going to be sharing with everyone in attendance tonight via email. Some of the material that we're going to be going over is a little bit heavy, and some of it may be triggering for some of you in attendance. If you need to take a minute to take care of yourself, please take a second, turn off your camera, take a step away, take a couple of deep breaths, and we are going to also work collectively to check in with everybody as we go through the slideshow. So here we go. So maternal mental health is defined using a definition that we are all familiar with when it comes to resilience. So maternal mental health, much like everybody's mental health, means being able to cope with challenges that come up on a regular basis with normal stresses, working productively and fruitfully, and feeling like you're making a contribution to your community. On the other side, perinatal mood and anxiety disorders is a term that encompasses disorders that occur during pregnancy and up to a year after a woman gives birth. Prenatal and postpartum can be used to explain more specifically when the disorders occur. And perinatal refers to the time during and immediately after pregnancy. So when we refer to PMADS, it is a umbrella term that encompasses all of the perinatal mood disorders that could happen during pregnancy and postpartum period, which is up to a year after giving birth. So this slideshow features cartoons from a phenomenal book that was written by a clinician named Karen Kleiman. The link to the book is at the end of the slideshow, and it is called Good Moms Have Scary Thoughts. And instead of reading all of the text on each of the slides, I want to really feature the cartoons that I've included in the slideshow, because I think that they really give a phenomenal depiction of what the internal workings of somebody who's experiencing prenatal or postpartum depression or anxiety is feeling. So when it comes to the transition to motherhood, a lot of people don't realize that all new moms have intrusive thoughts to some extent during the transition to motherhood, and that becoming a parent inherently involves some sort of loss because of the identity shift from being someone who doesn't have to think about bringing a baby to run errands or making bottles or pumping or lack of sleep. And so in this cartoon, you have two women, maybe it's her mother and her mother-in-law supporting a woman saying, congrats on your baby, your life is now complete. And she's saying out loud, thank you, that's so sweet of you to say. But her thoughts are, look at all I have, what about all I've lost? I've lost all connection to my former self, my career, my body, time with friends, alone time with my husband, any sense of who I am, spontaneity, intimacy, and financial security. I have no privacy, no confidence, no freedom to come and go. I have no idea what I'm doing, no time to do anything I used to do. I'm trying to be grateful, but I miss me and the life I had before. And these thoughts are not indicative of a perinatal mood disorder. These are normal thoughts that the majority of mothers have when they have a new baby. And it's really important for our community to normalize the transition and normalize that those scary thoughts don't necessarily mean that somebody has a perinatal mood disorder. So here's a list of PMADS. Each of the slides that follow is going to go over in detail each of the ones that I'm going to go over. So how do you differentiate when somebody has what we call the baby blues and when someone has a mental health disorder? So within the first 3 weeks after childbirth, there are severe hormone fluctuations that include rapid mood changes in the first few days after giving birth. 80% of moms experience the baby blues, and they usually disappear by 3 weeks postpartum. So it's really important to recognize that if you're within the first 3 weeks postpartum, unless you've had symptoms of postpartum of perinatal depression or anxiety in your pregnancy, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to experience postpartum depression or anxiety. So how do we determine when somebody is experiencing a perinatal mood disorder? So the equation that we use is frequency and intensity and duration equals the level of distress. So how frequently is someone experiencing these thoughts? Are they preventing you from participating fully in your life? The example of this would be someone who's crying all the time. And then we want to look at the intensity. How distressing is this feeling for you? Are you able to distract yourself? So the example of this would be crying might interrupt what you're trying to do. And then duration is how long is each episode lasting, with the example being crying all day for many days in a row. And if it's hard to imagine a respite from these thoughts, or if your fantasies involve self-harm or suicide, it's really important to get help from a qualified mental health professional. So the first slide that we have here is on postpartum depression. I'm not going to read the stats on the side of the page, but again, I want to look at the cartoon. So you have someone here, she's being asked maybe by a friend, how are you? She says fine, but she's thinking, I'm overwhelmed, I'm terrified, I'm sleep deprived. I'm sorry I had this baby. Not really. I mean, I love my baby, but I don't feel good. I don't know what I'm doing. I can't think straight. I don't even recognize myself. I don't feel like myself at all. I'm irritable all of the time. I'm miserable most of the time, and I cannot breathe. And the most important thing to point out in this slide is that the thoughts that this woman is having does not mean that she doesn't love her baby. It doesn't mean that she's not grateful that she has a child, but she is clearly suffering and needs support. The other thing that I want to draw attention to is that so frequently women that are feeling this way are projecting out to other people that they're fine. The next slide is on postpartum anxiety. This is, again, the diagnosis requires differentiating a normal transition from an anxiety disorder, and it's always about that frequency, intensity, and duration. So this mom is saying she feels like the weight of the world is on her shoulders, that there's so much to worry about. Did he get enough milk? Will there be a catastrophic earthly event that will obliterate us all in an instant? What's that noise that he's making? What does it mean? Should I call the pediatrician? Does he have a fever? His head looks too big. Did the doctor measure his circumference the last time we were in? I'm so nervous. What if I make the water too hot in the bathtub? Don't leave me alone with him. And again, it's so clear from these thoughts that this woman desperately loves her baby, but her anxiety has reached a level where she really needs support and help. Postpartum rage is often a byproduct of postpartum depression or postpartum anxiety, but it's more and more being recognized alone as a perinatal mood disorder. So this is bouts of unexpected anger, including intense episodes of rage. So this is a mom who's very sweetly repairing with her baby, saying, I'm so sorry I yelled today. I'm sorry I got so mad at your sister in front of you. I'm sorry you heard me scream, that I wish everyone would just leave me alone. I'm sorry you have such an angry mommy. I hope to do better tomorrow. This is postpartum obsessive compulsive disorder. These symptoms may include intrusive, repetitive, and persistent thoughts or mental pictures, where thoughts are often about fears of hurting or killing the baby or curiosity about hurting or killing the baby. This is something that is tremendously disturbing to the mom experiencing the thoughts, and frequently can be something that prevents her from getting help because she's so scared to tell her provider that these are the thoughts that she's having for fear that someone's going to take her baby away. So this is a mom who's saying, I'm afraid that I'm going to find my baby dead in her crib. I think my baby will fly out of her car seat and into a ditch. I think I will drop my baby onto the cement when I'm going down the stairs. I think that I am unfit to be a mother, while the woman next to her is saying, don't you think this is the best time of your life? Postpartum psychosis is extremely rare. It's less than one, it's 1 to 2 women out of 1,000 births. So less than 1% of women experience postpartum psychosis. Psychosis always requires a detachment from reality. So you can see this mom, she's been awake for days. She can't sleep. She feels like she's being swallowed by darkness, having weird thoughts and seeing things that other people are telling her that's not there. This is always an emergency and usually requires inpatient care. Thankfully, across the country, there are more and more inpatient facilities where moms can actually go with their babies so that maternal attachment is supported and not disrupted. Postpartum PTSD is experienced by approximately 9% of women following childbirth, and it usually has to do with a childbirth that doesn't go the way that the woman is hoping it will go prior to delivery. Here we have a mom who had a severe postpartum hemorrhage and needed surgery postpartum. Another mom who had an unplanned C-section, and then another mom who had a baby in the NICU. And each of these moms are experiencing they're experiencing flashbacks and intrusive emotions that are related to the traumatic event. And this is something that can also be treated with a qualified mental health professional. The scariest thoughts are not standalone thoughts, but they can be standalone thoughts. We have here mom who is experiencing severe thoughts of suicidality. She's saying she wants to go to sleep and never wake up. Her baby deserves a better mother. Everyone would be better off without me. I cannot do this for one more day. I'm not sure if I want my life to end or my suffering to end. Wouldn't those be the same thing? And this is also a sign that you need immediate medical intervention. Any thoughts of suicide should be taken seriously, even if you feel absolutely certain you would never do anything to harm yourself. And suicidal thoughts frequently represent a desire for an escape. An evaluation and treatment by a mental health professional is necessary in this case. So I know I just went through a humongous overview of a lot of different perinatal mental health disorders. I'm going to pass the mic back to Dahlia so that she can ask our panelists the next question.
Thank you, Carly. That was really excellent and just so comprehensive on such a difficult and sensitive topic. You really helped us to understand the terms and the parameters. And you hit on so many important points. And one of the things you mentioned is that some women don't know that depression can also affect women during pregnancy. And we are so fortunate to have Esty here tonight, who's a survivor of both perinatal depression and postpartum depression. So I want to welcome Esty. And Esty, I'd like to ask you, before you became pregnant, had you ever heard of perinatal mood disorders or known anyone who had it? Can you please speak to us about your experience going through this? What kind of support you received?
Thank you, Dahlia. I've written up what I plan to share tonight, and I'll ask for your understanding as this isn't my usual style. But I've chosen to let go of a more natural flow in favor of the intention and carefulness that this topic deserves. I'll be perfectly honest with you all, I don't really want to be here. This is an incredibly personal and was tremendously painful. But I'm here because I know without a doubt that this program can save lives. I know that by being here, someone, and probably many someone, will hear their story and the parts of ours we are choosing to share and discover that they are not broken and that they are not alone. I know this because it was a program like this very one in which I finally understood that I was not broken, that I was not alone. My first introduction to postpartum depression was through a serial story in the Bina magazine. I was a teen in high school, flipping through the articles, and all I actually remember is how the woman depicted was always in bed. And in a way that was almost irritating, it never seemed to end. For months, every time I opened that magazine, the woman was still there, languishing in bed. I recently heard someone say, people don't talk about their experiences with postpartum depression and anxiety because people don't realize that they have postpartum depression and anxiety. And this resonated so strongly with me because for a long time, I didn't know. I had this image in my head of what postpartum depression looked like, and it wasn't reflected in my experience. And I remember even telling a friend of mine when my son was about 6 months old, I don't think I have postpartum depression, but I feel like I'm just on the brink. What did that even mean? It meant that I didn't understand my own experience because I wasn't in bed all the time, because I wasn't feeling just despair. Maybe motherhood was just this difficult. Maybe my baby cried more than others. Or maybe I just wasn't as capable, resilient, and laid back as I had thought. That last option felt like the most likely reason for what I was experiencing. I got lucky, and my first experience with postpartum depression resolved on its own by the time my son was 8 months old. As he learned to sleep through the night, and I did too, I fell into the rhythm of motherhood with my self-esteem slightly scarred, but unaware of the reality and gravity of my experience. Sometimes people don't talk about postpartum depression because they don't actually know they had postpartum depression. When I was about 4 months pregnant with my second daughter, I sat on my bed and pulled my laptop onto my lap. I opened up a new tab and typed into the Google search bar, "Do people get depression in pregnancy?" My pregnancies had never been the glowing, inspiring ones you see in the media. I had always noticed an almost immediate shift in feeling a kind of constant low-grade irritation when I was pregnant, aside from the physical strains, but this time felt different, deeper, and relentless. And at this point had brought me to my Google search. A Google search. This is how I discovered that 20% of women develop depression in pregnancy. 20%? How could this even be? I'd stood beside tens of women, friends, and close family through pregnancy and postpartum, and I didn't know of a single one who had been depressed in their pregnancy. This awareness was mildly helpful, and soon after I asked my doctor for medication. His response was hesitant. His concern was for the baby's well-being, and I didn't push. After all, this would probably end once I gave birth, as my pregnancy moodiness had in the past. I'll drop the spoiler now. It didn't end. It got worse than I could have imagined and lasted longer than that Venus cereal. And still, that confusion that I had after my son was born remained. Was this really PPD? It didn't look like anything I had thought it was. Let me give you some context. At this point, I was parenting three active and demanding toddlers. All were getting fed, dressed, bathed, played with, and loved daily. I was working part-time. I was attending multiple weekly doctor's appointments to fix all the things birth had done to my body. And I was hosting twice weekly social events and Shabbos meals for anywhere between 20 to 45 college students in my home. To the outsider, to me, I seemed to have it all worked out. This couldn't be PPD. The more likely diagnosis, a bad attitude, anger issues, incapable, disorganized, overwhelmed, isolated, broken. Here's the thing about perinatal mood disorders, and honestly about most mental health struggles. The wise Karen Kleiman of the Postpartum Stress Center says it well. One of the worst parts about the symptoms of postpartum depression and anxiety is that they don't feel like symptoms. They feel like who you are. You asked about the support I had, and while I wish that I could give an invigorating response, the honest truth is that I didn't have much. I filled out PPD screening forms at multiple OBGYN and pediatrician appointments that were never followed up on. I asked doctors for medication multiple times and heard reluctant responses focused on my baby's development. I cried actual tears to nurses and receptionists who handed me papers with websites listed that led nowhere. I saw two therapists, both of whom offered validation but weren't well-trained in the nuances of perinatal mental health. The people I was told to turn to for support didn't seem to know the path forward any better than I did. I was reluctant to share this part of my experience because I don't want it to be deflating, but I was encouraged to share it because, as Julia wisely recognized, this experience is not at all uncommon. The understanding around mental health support is cloudy at best in our general population, as well as in the medical community. This is even more highlighted during the perinatal period, when our societal expectation is that it be a joyful time. We're getting better at reducing the communal stigma, and the medical community is becoming more integrative in care, but we need to move faster and with more urgency. This is why events such as this one are so necessary. We need awareness and understanding of how we can support our friends and family in practical ways. And more so, we need practical resources, real people who understand the specifics of these conditions to connect to the very real people who shouldn't have to suffer alone. With my third request for medication finally being met, I broke through the suffocating fog I had been living in for over a year. With education about my raging anger, ever-present irritability, the frightening, intrusive thoughts I had been experiencing, I felt empowered to separate my identity from these symptoms. By hearing other women's stories, like the one on that Zoom call, I began to see that I was not broken. Over time, and with a myriad of life changes, I began to heal.
Thank you so much, Esty, for sharing your story of resilience. And I'm just in awe of your strength and your courage. And we are all just so grateful for your willingness to be open and share with us tonight. Thank you. As we learned from each of your bios, you're all mental health professionals. Alana, can you speak with us about how it was for you going through postpartum depression as a mental health professional yourself?
Sure. So I already knew that I was predisposed to having postpartum issues since I had experienced some postpartum OCD after my eldest was born. But my last pregnancy was really complicated by being high risk, and I was pretty much on rest throughout the 9 months. That was really especially traumatic for me, being an avid runner, and I was struggling without that outlet. I was more in a survivor mode, and so consumed with getting through one day at a time, and really scared of going into preterm labor as I had been preparing throughout the duration of the pregnancy. But after I made it to the finish line and delivered a healthy baby girl, I had felt relief, but I continued to feel intense worry that somehow something bad would happen to the baby. And this evolved into feeling incompetent. Somehow I wasn't fit to take care of her. My mom had been visiting from Florida, staying with me for a month after I'd given birth to help care for me and for the baby. And I knew that having an extra set of hands was something that was helpful, but I still couldn't manage. So I felt really ashamed as a mom, because this was my fourth child and I should be able to take care of her. Ashamed as a therapist, because, you know, I knew what coping skills that, that I was supposed to use, but I felt like if I was any good as a therapist and as a mother, that I would be able to help myself. I was angry and disappointed that I couldn't meet my own expectations. And my well-meaning husband asked me what was going on and why I was so upset all the time. He tried to encourage me to feel happy and to have gratitude for everything that we had, especially healthy children. But however, that only perpetuated feelings of worthlessness and shame, because I really didn't feel that way. And so instead I started to internalize all my thoughts and feelings. To add insult to injury, I hemorrhaged about 3 weeks after I'd given birth and had been rushed to the emergency room where I was treated for a uterine infection. And my OB urged me to start taking Zoloft due to the difficult circumstances of the perinatal and postpartum trauma that I had suffered. About a week later, I had received a phone call from a social worker at the hospital where I'd given birth, who was doing a routine check-in. And she indicated if I needed any postpartum support, that I could return her call. I pondered for about a week before returning that call, and my intention was just to inquire about the services. I was so convinced that I needed to sound together, put together, and that I would not give any indication that I needed anything from her, just, you know, solely seeking information. However, I started crying immediately when she asked me how she could be helpful. And I really believe it took me longer to reach out, because as a therapist, I felt like I could help myself. I wanted to help myself, but that wasn't happening. The last straw to getting help really broke during my 6-week postpartum checkup, when I had a panic attack on the exam table. And my dear friend and running partner, who also happens, you know, who also happens to be an OB, who had held my hand during the C-section, she was in the office that day and called my husband, concerned for my well-being, and indicated that I should not be left alone with the kids. I was in shock, I was confused, and I was hurt that she had told him that. But I clearly did not understand the gravity of my condition. And it was only after that intervention that I had sought help and began the long path towards recovery. I know you heard me say that my mom was with me after the baby was born, and she was there for every birth. And there was no doubt that she was a tremendous help in caring for the baby. But like I and others can tell you, that even those who are closest to us and people who, you know, have known us for our entire lives can't see inside of our heads and know what we're feeling. So well-meaning spouses, friends, relatives, medical professionals who do notice troubling signs that their interventions could likely be met with anger and hostility from the women suffering from PPD, because I know I was hurting, but I'll really forever be grateful to those who encouraged me to help myself.
Thank you so much, Alana. I'm sure your experience of struggling, despite intellectually knowing how you'd guide someone else, resonates with so many of us. And I just truly thank you for your authenticity in sharing that experience with us today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Carly, after hearing these women so bravely share their challenges and their different experiences in accessing help, I want to circle back to you with a question. How can women going through these struggles and challenges find the support and the resources that they need?
It's such a great question. And before I jump back into my slideshow, I really want to take a minute to really thank Esty and Alana for sharing their stories with us. I think that we are so lucky to be hearing from people who are more than survivors, they're thrivers in being able to share your stories. And you know, I know that we've spoken personally before doing this program, and both of you have echoed that writing out your stories has really been a transformative experience for you. And I think that it really shows the value that help can come from more than one direction, and that the story is never fully over, that there's always an opportunity to take what you've learned along the way and help to make an impact for other people, which can also be a transformative path to healing. So thank you both for sharing that with everybody here. I'm gonna share my screen. And before I talk about self-advocacy, which I think was a really significant thread in both of your stories, Esty and Alana, I wanna also talk about the importance of flexibility in being able to plan for birth and postpartum, because research has shown that actually our perceptions are the most important thing to protect us from developing a perinatal mood disorder. So what that means is a lot of people will, you know, get pregnant, Baruch Hashem, and they'll be so excited for a delivery and they'll have an idea in their mind for how they want a delivery to go or how they want their postpartum experience to be. And then if that looks a little bit different, drastically different, then sometimes that can exacerbate intrusive thoughts and bring somebody to the point of crisis. This is especially relevant when it comes to breastfeeding. For a long time, people thought that breastfeeding was a protective factor against postpartum depression. More research, more recent research is actually showing that that's not the case. The highest risk for postpartum depression is correlated with women who felt strongly that only good mothers breastfeed. And if you have the capacity to be flexible and recognize that good mothers feed their babies, and that it doesn't matter whether that is with breast milk, formula, or a combination of the two, that you're actually going to be on your way to protecting yourself against developing postpartum depression or postpartum anxiety. Being aware of the signs and being aware of the realities of what it feels like to have a mood disorder in pregnancy is one of the most important things that you can do, because it will allow you to get help as early as possible, which, as we heard from Esty's story, can be really challenging because so many providers are not well-versed in PMADS. Asking for help, finding or creating a support system, responding honestly to screenings, and then practicing self-care. So there's also a lot of research that shows that the physical dysregulation that happens as a result of having a baby, lack of regular meal planning, lack of sleep, all of those things are risk factors. So either having a support system, whether that means a postpartum doula, a mom, a friend who can come and hold the baby while you take a shower, change your clothes, or take a nap, being able to do those things, and then self-compassion. So we have this cartoon here. It's maybe it's this woman's spouse who's asking, do you need anything? She's saying nope, but if you look at her thoughts, she's saying, I need a home-cooked hot meal. I need a shower. I need a break. I need some time to myself. I need some sleep. I need someone to understand how bad I feel sometimes. I need time, rest, help, food, hugs, support, cookies, quiet, nourishment, help with laundry, cleaning, cooking. I need acknowledgement, understanding, and support. When it comes to finding that support, the right provider really matters. So these cartoons depict two women who are both experiencing some symptoms of perinatal mood disorders. So you have a woman who's in therapy, who her therapist is asking, are you feeling any better today? And she says, not really. I'm anxious all the time. I still can't eat, and I'm worried that I will end up doing something that will hurt my baby. And then her therapist responds, do you really think you could hurt your baby? And her response is, oh my gosh, I don't think so. Oh my gosh, do you think I could hurt my baby? So you can see that this therapist, while she likely has the best of intentions, is not actually getting to the root cause of this woman's intrusive thoughts and is likely making her feel shame and stigmatized because of her response to this woman verbalizing her fear that she's going to hurt her baby, which is a clear symptom of a perinatal mood disorder. On the other side, you have a woman who's probably at her 6-week postpartum checkup, who verbalizes to her provider that she doesn't like the way she's feeling. One provider, who you can't see on the screen, says, "Oh, that's normal. You just had a baby. Just relax. Everything will be fine," right? Because the 15 minutes that they provide for a 6-week postpartum checkup is totally enough to get into all of the intricacies of not liking the way that you're feeling. On the other hand, the other provider says, "Why don't you tell me more about how you're feeling? Did you know that postpartum depression and anxiety are common? Let's talk about how you're feeling and see what we need to get you feeling better." So that woman's really lucky to have a provider who's willing to talk to her. And sometimes, unfortunately, you will be your best advocate in finding someone who's willing to spend the time and talk to you about how you're feeling and make sure that you're going to get help. The last slide that I'm going to share is a slide of resources, again, that will be shared with everyone after the presentation today. It includes a link for a psychopharmacology consult for professionals, which I'll talk more about at the end of the program, and some links for PSI, which is Postpartum Support International, that has a directory for providers split up by state, for people who are trained in perinatal mood disorders. A provider who is trained is going to be most qualified. So someone who is either a member of PSI or a perinatal mental health counselor. And I also included the names of the books that the cartoons came from. All right, back to you, Dahlia.
Thank you, Carly. Those tips and resources are so helpful. Just getting a better understanding of the preventative and the protective factors, and just how to get the right provider, right? One who validates your experience and your feelings and who really takes the time to understand what you're feeling really could make or break your experience. And it's just so important. And we're all so much stronger when we have the tools to advocate for ourselves. Esty and Alana, I'd really love to hear from both of your perspectives. We all know that it could be so hard to figure out the right things to say and the right things to do to our friends when they are struggling. And even if people mean well, and we mean well, we don't always know what can be helpful. What do you think friends could do to help and support each other during this time? Esty, if you could please share your perspective, and then followed by Ilana.
Okay. Alana's going to share some excellent ideas of practical and directed help, and I'd like to take another perspective. As I mentioned before, a big piece of my experience with perinatal depression was that I didn't know anyone else who had experienced it. This was a huge roadblock to my recovery because I had no one to turn to who could tell me, "I've been there too. These are some things that helped me. Here are some well-informed professionals to call." Something more internal that made asking for help really challenging was the stigma surrounding mental health struggles. I was afraid to tell people, both friends and professionals, the true extent of what I was going through, because what if they thought I was just a terrible, negative person? Or what really shut me up? What if they took my kids away? I knew that stigma is broken through sharing our stories, and that there were women out there who, like me, needed to know who they could trust to open up to. And so, uncomfortable as it was, I began to drop small anecdotes into everyday conversations. And as I opened up in discussions about pregnancy, childbirth, and parenting, conversations that we all have regularly, I discovered something astonishing. The number of women turning back and saying "me too" was way more than 1 in 7. The circumstantial evidence that I've collected through my professional work and personal conversations has shown closer to 4 in 7 women in our firm community experiencing perinatal mental health. While I'm not in the position to state conclusively why that is, I've seen it to be true. And so here's what I want to propose in terms of how we can support our friends and family: honesty, compassion, reciprocity. Honesty in the way we talk about our experiences. When we share our everyday challenges in parenting, relationships, balancing life, we give other people permission to share their challenges too. When we acknowledge that there are difficulties that we each have, we allow others to share their difficulties without shame. The wonderful Dr. Carrie Barcone says, "Be so completely yourself that everyone else feels safe too." Compassion means recognizing the reality that this could be you just as easily as it was me. Pema Chodron says, and I quote, "Compassion is not a relationship between the healer and the wounded. It's a relationship between equals. Only when we know our own darkness well can we be present with the darkness of others. Compassion becomes real when we recognize our shared humanity," end quote. Nobody wants to be pitied, and nobody will ask for help when they fear the response. Compassion means showing up with respect for those who are in a time of need, showing up with the humility that we all have times of need. And on that note, reciprocity, and I think this one is really important because with our strong values of chesed, we are so good at giving. We need to get better at receiving because there's judgment around receiving, and we remove that by modeling that it's okay. When you ask for help, you become a safe person to ask for help. In small ways, when you're having a hard day and you need someone to take a child for a play date, or when you're overwhelmed and ask a neighbor to pick up some groceries while she's out, you give permission to others to do the same. They say it takes a village. This is how we create that village.
Thank you, Esty. It sounds like your experience has just totally changed the way that you approach relationships and friendships, and just given us true insight as what it really means to be there for someone as equals, right? Where there's not this hierarchy, where it could easily just be you, just like it could easily be me, just like it was for you, and recognizing that we have to help others not feel alone. And by sharing, we invite others to share as well. Alana, we'd love to hear from you how you think friends could help support each other during this time.
Okay. I feel like the most helpful friends for me personally were the ones who had reached out to check in and ask how I was doing, and not necessarily checked in to see how the baby was doing. They would offer to come and hold her so that I could lay down to take a nap or take her for a walk. Settle her. She would literally scream for 4 to 5 hours a night, usually from around 5 p.m. to 10 p.m. It was just kind of never ending. So as long as it took her to stop screaming, they would stay. I had friends that set up a meal train, where members in the community will make dinner for the family. And I was lucky to have that for 6 weeks after after I'd given birth. And even including lunch for mom the next day, make enough so that there are leftovers. That's helpful. Making food that, my kids would eat because they were extremely picky. That was definitely helpful. So while supporting others who were recovering postpartum, I try to pay it forward by making dinners that are kid friendly or inquiring, what foods their kids like, just to simplify it for them, so that parents really have one less responsibility to think about during this recovery period. Friends that were openly, listening and inquiring about recovery, asking how they could be helpful, or better yet, they were just coming in, kind of scanning the room and going, hey, what needs to be done? Washing dishes, folding laundry, coming in to hang out with my older kids to just, to give them some attention. And I really, really appreciated just that hour to be able to close my eyes and, have an extra set of hands just to come and hold the baby so I could sleep. I was so beyond sleep deprived for many, many, many months.
Thank you, Alana. And those tips that you just shared on how to support and talk to our friends and just show up and be there for each other. And the fact that you're paying it forward is just so beautiful. And just really helps us all, I think, be more sensitive. And these are practices that we can all incorporate into our lives to better care for those that we love. Alana, in our different conversations leading up to this program, we love seeing you light up when you talked about running and the role that running plays in your life, not just as a physically healthy practice, but as a mental health exercise for yourself. And we're all so excited about the upcoming marathon that you're doing to celebrate your birthday. Happy birthday. Can you speak to us a little bit about what role running has in your life?
Yeah. That's fine. Anybody that knows me knows that my favorite place to be is outdoors on a run. To me, running is just about nature and my eclectic playlists, because I always have to be with music. It's really forever been my solace when I'm stressed, when I'm happy, and really just allows me to connect with myself without any interruptions, except for the once in a while where I have to bend down and tie my shoelaces. So, but I really believe in the power of running and any exercise to help maintain a healthy emotional and physical self. And it was really devastating for me to lose that for the duration of my pregnancy. And I'm sure it was a major contributing factor to suffering from postpartum OCD and depression. So over the past 10 years, I've been fortunate, you know, very fortunate to race in half marathons. And I had completed my first full distance marathon in New York City just before my baby had turned 2 years old. And this summer, I will be 40, God willing, in a couple of weeks, that I decided to venture into something new, into the world of triathlons, and completed my first one this past summer. I really feel the type of mental and physical strength and resiliency that has taken so long to achieve. I get it through exercise. Oh, competitive racing really has been very therapeutic for me and just encourages me to persevere because it's me against myself. While I'm my biggest cheerleader, I'm probably also my harshest critic. And it just keeps me hopeful that as I, you know, continue practicing this level of self-care, that I'm worthy, I'm feeling good, and I continue to be mindful of maintaining and optimizing my mental health. So again, for my upcoming 40th birthday, I will be doing a half Ironman this coming summer, God willing. So I have a tremendous level of gratitude for what my mind and my body have been capable of achieving throughout this journey.
I'm in awe and really wish you so much luck and hatzlacha on your triathlon. And I think so many of us could identify with that joy that either exercise or other outlets bring us, and what we feel when we can't do those things, or what when we can do those things, and what how we feel when we can't do what we love to do. So thank you for sharing that. Esty, as we were preparing for this program, you described your experience as transformative. That's so powerful. And I was wondering if you can share with us how that really impacted you.
Yeah, so I resisted the inclusion of this question at first because being here tonight is not about me and my experience. But again, with the guidance of Sarit and Julia, who put this panel together with so much wisdom and sensitivity, I recognize that the changes I've made are changes I could have afforded to make before being kind of forced into them through my experience. And so I hope it's helpful to share some of those with you. I've noticed that so often mental health is kind of the shadow of our life experience. We go through life's events and our mental health follows behind, impacted by whatever we've been through. And then sometimes the impact is so large that the shadow falls over the path ahead of us and forces us to stop short until we can regain balance. But maybe we get to adjust this arrangement. For a few years there, I was forced to prioritize my mental health because of what had happened. Now I choose to. My mental health leads and life follows. And this is reflected in the choices I make about how I schedule and spend my time, what I do and don't take on as responsibilities, how and whom I invest in relationally, and so much more. And this doesn't mean I'm taking it easy. It means I'm taking it wisely. The other thing that has been transformative about this experience is the way I approach my relationship. Going through this opened my eyes to which friends had the capacity to show up and which friendships had the strength to make it through. Like I shared before, these were the people who were honest with me, and so I could be honest with them. The ones who met me with compassion and not judgment. The friends who weren't afraid of my pain, who knew that I was so much more than what I was showing them in those moments. All of the research shows that the key factor to resiliency is having caring and supportive relationships. But what I see in my practice, as well as in my experience, is that when you're in a dark place, you don't necessarily have the energy or the tools to reach out. often your symptoms are even unintentionally pushing people away. So that support system of people who know you well needs to be in place before any sort of difficult experience. And so there's a certain expectation that I have of my relationships now, and I don't allow for any less than that. And let me clarify, this expectation mostly falls on me to show up authentically and to be honest always, to share completely, and to invest in people who can accept my vulnerability entirely and are willing to show up in those same ways. Aside from the love and support this fills my everyday with, there's comfort in knowing that what happened to me could never devolve in the way that it did again because of the support system and honesty that I invest in daily. And I really hope this doesn't come across as preachy, because I know all of this is really hard, and it took a lot of pain and support and good therapy to get here. And still I struggle every day to show up in a way that is supportive and authentic. But I share all of this in the hope that just one of you relates and finds some strength and hope.
Thank you, Esty. Your words, your strength, it's so inspiring to hear you speak about your experience. And I think it's just such an important message to be authentic and to make sure that in your life, you are filling your life with real caring and supportive friends and family in the most authentic way. Thank you. Carly, as this is an event organized by the Mikvah, we would love it if you could also put on your Mikvah administrator, college teacher hat and speak to us a little bit about how postpartum depression could affect women's comfort, use, and feelings about the Mikvah. What do you think Mikvah Oat attendants and others could do to help?
I so love that this question is included in this panel discussion. And I'm really glad that the framework of Mikvah is also a piece of the discussion when it comes to struggling postpartum and having really big challenges when it comes to relating to yourself. And then obviously the result of that is relating to your spouse. And so I think that there's a lot of things that Mikvahs can do. I also want to say that I think college teachers can also do a lot to prepare women for the realities of what postpartum might look like. And they can be a really important channel to providing that essential information to help ease the transition from being a couple to being a couple with a young child. I know at our Mikvah, if somebody discloses to me that they're coming for a postpartum visit, we try to make the Kala suite available so that they can take an hour for self-care and really pamper themselves in our large jacuzzi tub. And I think that that's something that a lot of Mikvahs are willing to accommodate. Going to the Mikvah postpartum means taking a really long look in the mirror at a body that feels really, really unfamiliar and uncomfortable to be in. And the transition to physicality in your marriage can also be a really stressful transition, because there's so many balls that you're juggling in the air in terms of wondering whether the baby's going to wake up, establishing a breastfeeding relationship with an infant, and then trying to be able to connect to your spouse in an intimate way that you haven't been for at least the past 6 weeks, if not longer. When women call me and tell me that they're coming postpartum, I also spend a lot of time normalizing that it's really normal to forget everything during the pregnancy period, and that needing a refresher course is really normal and really almost a universal experience for all women. The most important takeaway that I think I have is that Mikvahs can only make accommodations if women are willing to reach out and ask for them. And so while Mikvahs can be clear in policy and procedure on their website and in other materials, it's really important for women who are using the Mikvah to call the head shomeret, the Mikvah administrator, or the Mikvah director and ask for accommodations, a refresher course, or anything else that they may need to help ease the transition.
Thanks, Carly. I think this mitzvah could be really challenging, and it's so important to normalize and talk about those difficulties. It's also really comforting to know that women like you and Chai Chin help women fulfill this mitzvah with sensitivity, with compassion, and with empathy. So what a wonderful opportunity we have had to hear from all of you tonight. And before we move on, I just want to give our three panelists an opportunity to share any final thoughts or feelings you may have. Ilana, do you have anything that you want to share?
Sure. I really wanted to express my gratitude for the opportunity to be part of this panel and to share my story with everybody. I'm really as personal and as difficult as it was, since it was a really dark time in my life. My hope is really for it to help reduce the stigma that's felt with postpartum depression and anxiety. So thank you for that opportunity.
Thanks, Ilana. Esty?
Yeah, thank you all so much. And again, just a huge thank you to Julia and Sarit for the tremendous sensitivity that they had in the whole process of putting this panel together. For the women listening here who are feeling the ache of familiarity, I share with you a beautiful set of words by writer Matt Haig, Rain. You don't have to be positive. You don't have to feel guilty about fear or sadness or anger. You don't stop the rain by telling it to stop. Sometimes you just have to let it pour, let it soak you to your skin. It never rains forever. And know that however wet you get, you are not the rain. You are not the bad feelings in your head. You are the person experiencing the storm. The storm may knock you off your feet, but you will stand again. Hold on. Thank you.
I love that poem so much. I shared with Esty that I shared it with a client this week who said that it really resonated with her. And it really relates to my final message, which I actually want to go back to something that Esty quoted earlier in the program, which was a quote from Karen Kleinman, who's the same author of the books with the cartoons that were in the slideshow that I shared tonight. She said, one of the worst parts about the symptoms of postpartum depression and anxiety is that they don't feel like symptoms. They feel like who you are. And I hope that all of you who are listening, who, whether you've experienced any of these symptoms or have any of these diagnoses, or you know women in your life who have any of these symptoms or have any of these diagnoses, I hope that making the distinction between who you are and what you're experiencing is a lot easier for you after this program tonight.
Thank you, Carly. And thanks to all three of you for sharing all of your thoughts and feelings so honestly and openly. Esty, the quote that you shared means so much to me personally and professionally. I deeply, deeply believe that allowing ourselves access to all of our feelings, the joy, the pain, truly brings about healing. So the stories we heard tonight are journeys of strength and journeys of resilience. These women have shared their vulnerabilities and experiences of struggle and loneliness, as well as tremendous bravery and growth. Never the same, but stronger and more in tune with themselves and with others. Thank you so much. Carly, we're so grateful for the work that you do, your sensitivity, your willingness to educate and talk about this topic in our community. So many people struggle, and it's so important for people to know that they are not alone. Esty and Ilana, by sharing your experiences with us in such a real way, you have truly brought us into your hearts, into your journeys. And I really, like with my full heart, bless you with continued strength to talk about your own vulnerabilities in the hopes to continue to inspire others and to truly save lives.
Dahlia, we are so grateful to you for moderating this event. Your sensitivity and insight brought so much to this program. Thank you, Carly, Lana, and Esty, for serving as panelists in this program and sharing your expertise and your experiences with us tonight. You're all so amazing, and it's been amazing working with all four of you, and Julia, of course. Now it's time to take some of the questions from the audience that are in the chat. And before we turn to the questions from the audience, we're putting a link in the chat in case you'd like to make a contribution in support of tonight's program or future events like this. The link will take you to the Mikvah Emuna Society website, where you can make a contribution to the Robin Nyman Mikvah Education Fund. And we're also putting a link in the chat with a survey. We'd like to get your reactions to this event, and we'll also be sending out the survey after the event. We ask you to fill out the survey so we can continue to make our events responsive to your needs. And we'll also post a link in the chat to Carly's PowerPoint slides, which include helpful resources on the last slide. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Sarit. Carly, are you ready to take a few of our questions? Great.
Yes.
Thank you. One of the first questions that we have submitted is, what do you think about alternative treatments to medications for women who are afraid of the risks of taking medication during pregnancy?
This is a great question. And I think that we heard from Alana's story about how running was really therapeutic for her in her healing transformation. And I think that it's really important to have a good understanding of both the psychopharmacology options that are available that are safe to take during pregnancy, as well as the impact that alternative treatments can have in helping someone overcome postpartum anxiety and depression. There's a lot of research about how regular self-care practice, which includes eating a well-balanced diet, sleeping at least 7 hours a night, regular exercise, and maintaining regular activities of daily life can really encourage somebody and help them improve symptoms of postpartum depression and anxiety. But for some people, that's not enough. And it must be emphasized that there are a lot of psychiatric medications that are available that are safe to take during pregnancy as well as postpartum. And there are many on the market that are also safe for breastfeeding as well.
Okay, thank you, Carly. We have another question that came in that I think you can address. The questioner asks if you can comment on how you would suggest people handle some of these anxiety or depression issues within the first few months of pregnancy when someone might not be sharing with friends or family yet.
I think that Esty's story really spoke to this as well, in terms of setting yourself up with a support system that you feel safe to be vulnerable and authentic with. I know that everybody makes their own lines about when they feel comfortable disclosing that they're expecting to friends and family. And I think that it's important when you're drawing that line to ask yourself who you would want support from if, chas v'shalom, the outcome is not what you're anticipating or hoping for. And then making that line with that information in your head. So that way you don't feel like you're doing something that's outside of the ordinary by disclosing to someone when it's really before the normal time. I think a lot of people don't realize that most people who are pregnant in their early stages do have a few individuals that they share with because they know that they're going to need support. It's often when you feel physically the most changes in the shortest amount of time, the most physically ill, insecure. You feel like everybody's staring at you because you're unsure of whether that you're showing, even if you're only like 6 or 8 weeks along. And it's okay for you to draw that line privately with your spouse, with your Rav, however you want to draw that line, but with the recognition that you might want to disclose to one or two people in creating that village that is so essential for you to have the support that you need to build resilience.
That's very helpful. Thank you, Carly. One of the questions that came in was that it's very helpful to hear these women's experiences, but their stories stopped at recovery. What does the recovery process look like?
Essie or Alana, do you want to answer this question or do you want me to do it? Sorry to put you both on the spot.
I'm happy to share a little bit. Just that, you know, each person's recovery process is so unique to what's going on in their lives. A tremendous piece is getting the right support, getting enough sleep, getting the right nutrition, if needed, medication, exercise, moving your body, good therapy. But more than that, I think what's important to notice is that going through something like this has a ripple effect. And so, you know, the story doesn't end when you're feeling better. You know, it doesn't end when you feel back to yourself, because, you know, there was a significant amount of time where this was affecting your relationship and your kids and your community and your, so just all the things around you. So, you know, as we both shared, it's really transformative. It has a ripple effect, and that healing will have a lot of different components depending on who is experiencing it and what kind of ripple effect that had through their lives.
Thanks, Esty. Carly, can you address PPD for men and what would possibly be the causes?
Sure. So my slideshow in one portion of it did address that 10% of men actually develop postpartum depression. And research is starting to establish that men experience also severe hormonal shifts when there's a new baby in a relationship. There are a few other causes that might possibly contribute to postpartum depression in men. One of them being that the family unit has shifted and the primary relationship, at least in early infancy, is going to be mom and baby, and dad sometimes feels left out and sometimes might even feel resentful and then have a lot of shame as a result of feeling that resentment, which can start to evolve into postpartum depression or anxiety. There are perinatal mental health counselors or PMED trained therapists that can treat postpartum depression for men. And those same alternative treatments, focusing on self-care, focusing on good sleep, eating, exercise, hygiene, and then also on relationship health as well.
Thanks, Carly. We received another question about the PowerPoint specifically. Are the thoughts reflected in the cartoons exclusive to women experiencing PMADs, or can that also be somewhat normal at times?
I'm so glad someone asked this question, because the answer is so individual. Those thoughts as standalones, yes, they can be normal at times. They're in a book that is called All Moms Have Scary Thoughts, because it really is true that all moms have scary thoughts. When it's time to get help is when you have to look at that equation of frequency, intensity, and duration. If those thoughts are happening so frequently that it's hard to distract yourself from them, if they're happening and it's hard to take care of yourself and to maintain your regular daily living activities, like getting regular showers, eating, sleeping, and not because the baby's not sleeping. If you're up all night looking at the baby, making sure that the baby is still breathing night after night after night, and then duration, it being night after night after night, then it's time to get help. So yes, if you're having intrusive thoughts like that, yes, it can be normal. If they're happening so frequently that you can't focus on anything else, and it's starting to make you feel like you can't find respite from them, then it's time to get help.
Thank you. Carly, received a question asking for, you know, specific advice about dealing with the anxiety of a high-risk pregnancy. Do you have any sort of thoughts that you could share on that?
I think that it all goes back to building that village of support, finding providers that you feel like you can access at times when you need to ask a question to get an answer. Some providers will share an email address and they'll say, like, you know, I'm not going to give you my cell phone number until you're 37 weeks pregnant. But if you, you know, some providers will give you their cell phone number when you're first diagnosed as being high risk. Going for frequent scans so that you can see that everything is going the way that it should be, and finding a provider who supports you in that. There are amazing support groups that are available in communities for people who are experiencing high-risk pregnancies. And I think that it's important to find that village of not just medical providers, but also friends, a therapist, and community members that you can rely on as well.
Thank you so much, Carly. Thank you so much to everyone on this panel. Stay tuned for information from us on what will be our next event. And please fill out the survey if you haven't already. Thank you all for coming, and have a good night.